so thrilled that we're presenting Sound of Music in spring of 2014. This is a show we all have a tremendous history with and a love for. I sang the role of Mother Abbess when I was in seventh grade. Unfortunately, my classmates referred to me as the Mother Abscess. Took me a while to live that down. But my mother was absolutely convinced, because we performed so much as a family, that we should tour the country as the American Fun Traps. And to my great relief, my father said, no, we're not going to do that.
Like the captain in The Sound of Music, who tries his best to stop it happening.
It's true, yes. We were destined for humiliation, I think, if that had happened amongst our classmates, you know. And but the musical is never done, as you said.
We are embarking on a series of new productions of Rodgers and Hammerstein's great shows, with The Sound of Music in 2014, Carousel in 2015, The King and I in 2016, and South Pacific in 2017. So a really important exploration of some of the greatest masterpieces in the American musical theatre repertory.
Absolutely, and I first got to know Rodgers and Hammerstein in England when I was about 15, when I got roped in to play with a piano trio in the local repertory theatre. You used to play things in between the acts, you know, while people were eating their ice cream. And we played excerpts from, it was a little, two Italians, a violinist and a cellist, and me, while the pianist was sick. And I was absolutely astonished at the beauty and the imagination and the originality of this music. Well, I didn't put it like that, quite like that when I was 15, but it just knocked me out. And I think I've been to so many musicals, well, not so many, but a lot of musicals written more recently, and I'm sorry, nothing comes up to the standard, they are
to music theater what Puccini is to opera.
Yes, exactly.
Go immediately to the heart. I'm crying in 2 seconds as soon as The King and I begins.
Yes, it's
part of our culture. It's part of our the fabric of society.
And they write pieces that are absolutely perfect for opera companies. There are skills and resources that we can bring to these pieces that I think will make the experience of seeing them and hearing them really special.
I met Bonnie Raitt recently, and she was talking about her dad, about John Raitt, and he, along with Gordon McRae, were super famous singers of this repertoire, but John Raitt in particular. And she said that at the end of his life, he was sitting around the pool singing German Lieder, which begged the question, you know, how and why. But in that period, almost all of these singers were classically trained. And he went back to his roots and said how much he loved this repertoire. So you had a full use of an operatic style voice, which we only have today now in, and I don't mean only because it's wonderful, in crossover. But they're amplified, and in those days, music theater was not amplified.
Yes. It's so interesting because of all the great Rodgers and Hammerstein pieces, to me, this is the most operetta-like.
Yes.
It can benefit from classically trained voices, and also the movie has become so iconic. It's something that we all see in our mind's eye.
Yes.
Right.
And yet it was conceived as a stage show. And having studied recently the script, the book of the stage show, it's very different from the movie
in
many ways.
Yeah.
A number of the songs are in different places. There are a number of different musical numbers. The characters of the Baroness and Max are much more fleshed out in the stage show than they are in the movie.
The orchestration is quite different as well.
It is.
It'll be interesting to see this stage show.
Yeah,
I've never seen it.
It'll be fascinating to try and reclaim the show for this theatre, because it's lost that claim. And for us to be able to bring the resources, the scale of a major opera company and a major opera house to this most beloved of pieces, I think it is artistically going to be very exciting and very satisfying.